What's cracking, everyone? Titanicllama here, and with this episode we reach the midway point of the current content in Idleon. Though we may have reached the midpoint of the game, we are still wee little ones when it comes to Idleon. You know that annoying saying, the game doesn't really begin until you reach the end game? Idleon is kinda like that. I thoroughly enjoy the journey of building our characters up in their specialties, watching them slowly grow, getting stronger or better at what they are tasked with. But it's not until we reach World 5 that numbers really start to get crazy and we have access to all of the cool toys, but I'm getting well ahead of myself here. The topic of today is the Speed Hunt World Frostbite Tundra, or World 3. What do I mean by that? Well, from feedback that I've gotten and experienced myself, the game really seems like it slows down once we hit World 3. There could be a couple of reasons for this, and this is pure speculation and conjecture on my behalf, but I feel the reasons for this are, for a long while, World 3 was endgame content, so it wouldn't surprise me if Lava overtuned a few things here and there to slow the player base down. And then when he rebalanced Worlds 1 and 2, he might have left World 3 alone to push people to spend more time catching up the previous world's skills, as you can get through World 1 and 2 rather quickly these days. Secondly, a lot of the systems introduced in the Tundra are all long-term skills, which means you'll be coming back here constantly, so you just feel like you spend a lot of time in World 3. But why do I bring all of this up? Simple. World 3 can be a drag, which is fine if you're prepared for it, or we can dip into all of these candies we've been hoarding from the start of the playthrough and power through the Tundra, which I would highly suggest. But if you want to hear my reasoning for why, stick around to the end of the video. Okay, just like World 2, the skills introduced in World 3 have a lot to them, adding more layers of complexity to Idleon. Even the gathering skills are more complicated than the previous, more traditional gathering skills, but we will get into those in a little bit. First thing though, my goals for early World 3 were simple. Unlock the new World 3 skills, recraft my Amarok armor and use World 3 stones on them, and continue to push my stamps and alchemy. I won't be covering things like portal pushing, as I feel that should be fairly natural by now. Upon unlocking World 3 and entering the portal, don't do what I did and start clicking on everything like a squirrel on a sugar high. Anyway, what you'll want to do is talk to this Neapolitan knucklehead. He is our guide for this frozen funland. This is because this dude walks you through all of the new skills and asks you to complete a few things relating to them. Doing these quests first will also reward you with a few stamps relating to the new skills, which of course you should hand in and level these up. Quick shout out to all of those who forgot stamps even existed and haven't touched them since World 1. It's alright, even I neglect my stamps. Speaking of stamps and alchemy though, even though I had reached World 3, the majority of my dudes were still hanging out in World 1 and 2 collecting the materials that I would need to level up my stamps and bubbles, and to continue to improve my skill and gear when and where I could. Just as I did with the previous episode, towards the end of the video I'll have some info cards displaying my goals for World 3. I realised my goals for World 2 were a bit lofty in retrospect, so I'll only be making slight adjustments to the cards from Episode 3. And considering how little time I spent in World 3, there really wasn't a ton of alchemy progression anyway. Alright, enough ranting. Let's get into our shiny new skills from World 3.
Get it? Shiny?
Anyway. With that terrible pun out of the way, let's go over the first of our new gathering skills, trapping. Trapping is a pain in the ass. You'll learn to hate this skill pretty quickly, but we need to try and learn to love it. As critters, the resource we gather with this skill will be used heavily moving forward. To get this skill going, we want to buy a trap for each of our characters from the World 3 shop, and like all other tools, they can and should be upgraded as we progress through Idleon. Once we have our trap equipped, we need to head to where the wildlings are, the first of which would be these frogs that have now spawned on the slimes map in World 1. Once we are standing on a platform with critters, you'll notice a couple of options pop up in the top corner. These are Place Trap and Play Game. Play Game will start a mini game, but it's good to note that this mini game doesn't use your daily attempts and can be played as many times as you want. This mini game is simple yet frustrating. Simply put the little shitheads in the right box, and that's it. It's actually important to play, as it works a bit differently from previous minigames. Getting a higher score on this will actually give you bonuses that affect your trapping, like increased trapping experience, efficiency, and shiny chance, and a few more. The Place Trap button, on the other hand, is the meat and taters of the skill. Clicking on this will open this little interface. With this open, we can click on these options here to see what our rewards would be in this box here. And clicking or tapping on the highlighted option will place the trap for the selected amount of time. As for which is the most efficient, the shorter traps if you can claim them as soon as they complete, which is just super tedious and unrealistic. Go for whatever is comfortable for you and what suits your ability to play the game. If 8 to 12 hour traps suit you, then use them. If you can only check Idleon once a day, go with closer to 20 to 24 hour traps. The last thing to note here, and something that often goes unnoticed, is once you equip your little dudes with better traps, you can use these arrows here to switch between your currently equipped trap and all of the lower tier traps that came before it. For instance, once you upgrade to the silkskin trap, you will be able to use both silkskin and cardboard box traps. Once you upgrade to the wooden box traps, you'll be able to use wooden boxes, silkskin, and cardboard boxes, so on, so forth. Different traps have different amounts of times that you can place them for, and each different type of trap will either boost experience or shiny chance, allowing you to either focus on leveling up the trapping skill itself or increasing your shiny critter gains. And last but certainly not least, higher tier traps increase the number of traps that you can place. So remember, when you upgrade your traps, make sure to go and place your new trap. As mentioned in episode 3, hunters specialize in trapping and have a few talents focusing on boosting this skill, and one that helps with the tedium of trapping. These three here increase trapping efficiency, experience gain, and shiny chance. And I threw a few points into these guys, but the main attraction here is this guy, Eagle Eye. Once you've equipped and placed traps on your little dudes, after the selected amount of time has passed, you can use this ability on your hunter to collect and automatically replace every character's traps at once. If you want to change or move your traps to a different critter, you must do that on each individual character still. Using Eagle Eye incurs a penalty to the number of critters gathered and experience given to other characters, but I feel it's still worth using, and I wanted to level this up mainly as it reduces that penalty. As with every other resource in the game, critters have cards relating to them that you'll passively level up as long as you're collecting your traps. As far as gear goes, there isn't any that specifically increases trapping aside from upgrading the traps themselves. There is, however, a boost food that increases shiny odds when claiming traps. Oh yeah, remember to keep doing this dude's quest, as this is how you will unlock new critters to trap, so yeah, that's kind of important. Alrighty, as you've made your way through Idleon, you may have noticed these totems chilling on a couple of maps. The totems are how we will interact with the worship skill, and just like Baby's first trap, we will need to buy our first skull, which is the tool for worship, from the World 3 vendor. Equipping skulls should be done on each character, as this will start generating worship charge on them. And the reason we want to upgrade these skulls is because higher tier skulls increases the maximum charge for each character and also its charge rate. Before we go over using this charge, we'll quickly touch on the wizard and its talents that boost worship. Just like the hunter, we have these three that will increase efficiency, worship experience, and charge rate. And finally, this talent here, which is kind of like Eagle Eye, as it frees us up from having to actively go to a totem and worship on each and every character. This talent will siphon a percentage of the charge from your other characters, giving it to your wizard to use, cutting down on the micromanaging a great deal. Alrighty, with that out of the way, what do we actually use this charge on? Well, there's two things. The first of which is one of my personal favourite systems in Idleon. Upon clicking on Summon at any of these totems, you will start a cool little tower defence minigame. For the one person out there that has no idea what a tower defense game is, it's alright, I got you. The goal here is to place towers down onto the map, which will attack the mobs that spawn on an endless death march to break your totem. And you don't want that, it makes the totem sad. Anyway, you want to defeat the highest wave that you can. This will be remembered by the totem. And you can see by clicking on the totem after completing a tower defense game what your highest wave completed is. Which neatly brings us to the second option, worship. Worshipping gives you the rewards equivalent to your highest wave completed, so what's displayed in this box here. It's important to attempt to push to higher and higher waves as you unlock and level up your towers, which is something I haven't mentioned just yet, but I'll go over them in more detail when I cover construction. Other than gathering souls from this skill, the other reason to push your tower waves higher is at certain benchmarks you'll unlock prayers. These are equippable buffs that come with a curse. For example, one of the better early prayers is Skilled Dimwit, which increases your skilling efficiency at the cost of skilling experience, which for me is a no-brainer. More materials at the cost of slightly slower leveling? Sign me up. And finally, same as trapping, there's no gear that boosts worship, but again, there is a boost food that increases souls gained when worshipping, so there is that. I'm not too sure if I explained those skills or overcomplicated them, but regardless, we're moving on. Construction is the alchemy of World 3. It's a fairly deep system that we will be coming back to regularly. Construction buffs almost every aspect of your account in some way, but unlike alchemy, this is done by unlocking new systems instead of bubbles. Construction is split up into two tabs. We have the build tab and the cog tab. We will look at the cog tab first, as this is something that you'll want to continuously work on, similar to leveling up our alchemy bubbles. You'll want to keep claiming cogs, hoping to get better ones as we progress through Idleon. Okay, with the cog tab open, we have a few things to take note of and get started on. This is the cog board. Upon first opening this up, most of it will be locked off and we will want to fix that. To do this, we will need to click around on the board, finding which set of four squares have the lowest requirement. There will always be four matching. Once you've done that, toggle this place flags button and click on those squares. Placing flags onto squares will start to unlock those squares based on your flaggy rate, but more on that in a second. Next to the flaggy toggle, we have this toggle to trash cogs, but be careful with this. It's super easy to delete cogs accidentally, but don't stress if you do. We've all done it once or 20 times. As someone once said, with great power comes with great responsibility. You've been warned. On the other side, there's this eyeball that we can toggle a few times to display certain stats on our cogs. The only one that really matters here is EXP. Again, I'll explain more on this soon. Lastly, we have a toggle to open the cog shelf. This is where we produce the cogs to place onto the cog board. Upon first opening this up, you'll want to place three characters into the newbie cog slots to start producing those. The rest of your characters can be placed directly onto the cog board itself. I'd highly suggest placing your squire directly onto the cog board, as he has talents that'll increase his output in the construction skill. With characters in the newbie cog slots, you'll notice this bar starting to fill. Once it is full, you can claim a cog. This can overflow and stack, so you can leave it for a little while and come back and claim a few cogs. Though, the more cogs you have saved up, the more time it takes to save up an additional cog, so try not to leave this for too long without claiming them. Okay, let's go over the cogs themselves and what you should be focusing on, in my opinion. Cogs are completely random and there's no way to influence them, it's just a numbers game. But clicking on any claimed cog will display its stats. It will have some combination of build rate, flaggy rate, or a percentage boost to construction experience. Placing these cogs onto the board will add their bonus to your character's build rate and flaggy rate, the total of which you can see down in this panel here. Again, these are completely random, so any single cog could have build rate, flaggy rate, and a percentage bonus, or it could just have build rate alone and that's it. Now, on top of this, there are special types of cogs. I won't be explaining all the available ones, just the ones that we will be seeing for now. When claiming cogs, you will occasionally get ones that look like these. These cogs have additional bonuses that only affect certain squares around the cogs. And these are adj or adjacent cogs, diggle or diagonal cogs, the four directional cogs, uppy, downer, left and right, and finally row and column cogs. Clicking and dragging these cogs onto the board will highlight the areas that they're going to boost. That's all well and good, but what exactly does build rate, flaggy rate, even mean? Well, flaggy rate is the speed at which those flags we mentioned earlier will unlock the squares that you've placed them onto. And build rate is the measure of units contributed to whatever we have placed in the build slots in the build tab per hour. More on that shortly though. Before we can move on to the build tab, I want to explain what I was focusing on when it came to cogs. When first starting out, anything is better than nothing, so just throw whatever you get onto the board. Though, once I had filled out my board with cogs, whenever claiming new cogs, I would toggle the eyeball to display EXP. And replaced any cogs without an EXP boost to one with one. The reason for this is I wanted to boost my squire's building level as much as I could, as quickly as I could, as a higher building level on a squire with points in construction talents will contribute a lot more to build and flaggy rate than cogs ever will. Also, having a higher construction level raises the ceiling on the percentages that the cogs can receive. That was a lot, I know. You may have to rewatch that section a few times before it fully clicks, but it will eventually, I assure you. We're not out of the woods yet, we still have a lot to go through, but you know what we haven't had for a while? Fish facts! Did you know there are over 500 different species of shark in the world, and some sharks will go through over 20,000 teeth in their lifetime? I'd imagine dental care for sharks would cost a fortune. Moving on to the building tab. In this tab, we have three rows of stuff to build. This is what the build rate we were just talking about counts towards. Clicking on one of these signs or the building once you have unlocked it will allow you to assign them to one of the build slots at the bottom of this tab, which will start leveling it. Once this bar has been filled, you can click on the building to upgrade it, which will cost some amount of salt and a resource. More on salts later. Okay, this bottom row here will unlock shrines. Shrines are placeable objects that you can put down on maps to give your characters boosts, like increasing your damage, increasing your HP, or your carry capacity. These shrines can be leveled up like everything else in Idleon, and to do this you'll want to place them down onto a map that you have at least one character on, and every time you claim AFK gains from that character, the time claimed will count towards leveling up this shrine. Clicking on the shrine will display how long you will need to AFK for to level it up. Keep in mind, moving a shrine before it levels up will reset it back to zero. I personally just kept them on the map that my main character was pushing on. The middle row unlocks and increases the effectiveness of the towers for the worship minigame. Early on, getting the boulder roller and frozen up is a good idea. Leveling these up is how you'll eventually push to higher waves, as not only does it increase the tower's damage, but it reduces how many points it costs in the minigame to level towers up, leaving more points for more towers. Each individual tower defense is worthy of its own guide, and there are some really good ones out there already, so I won't be going into setups or anything like that in this video. Finally, we have the top row, which contains new systems and some quality of life improvements to unlock. I feel like most will only unlock up to the cost cruncher, maybe the trapper drone by the time we reach world 4, so I'm going to explain up to the cost cruncher and leave the rest for the world 4 video. Okay, the two simple ones first. Chest space and cost cruncher. For those of you playing bingo, I feel like these are pretty self-explanatory, but unlocking and leveling up chest space, get this, gives you more chest space. Pretty amazing, right? Right? All jokes aside, by this point of the game, you'll be craving more storage, so this is actually pretty good. And cost cruncher makes it cheaper to upgrade any of these buildings. Note that it only reduces the cost of upgrading, not the build requirement. Next up, we have three slightly more complicated systems, these being the library, the Deathnote, and the salt lick. First cab off the rank will be the library. Once this is unlocked, you can use this new bookshelf to check out books. These books are pretty cool. So with the library interface open, there's a bit to take in here, so let's start here. This shows how many books you currently have available to check out. This displays how long until you stack another one, and the more books you can check out, the longer it takes to build up, similar to how the cogs work. Up here, we can use these arrows to cycle through the base classes in the game, and the arrows below those will cycle through the subclasses like Squire and Elemental Sorcerer, etc. Our last set of arrows here will cycle through the talents associated with the class we selected with the other arrows. Here we can see our current level range for our books, and finally we can click on this button to check out a book. All this is great and all, but what do these books do exactly? Well, once you've checked out a book, it will have a random level between the range displayed in the library for the talent you selected in the library. If the number is higher than what you currently have, using this book will increase the maximum level of the selected talent, allowing us to continue to push our levels higher and higher as we progress through Idleon. Eventually, we're going to find ways to increase the maximum level of the books that we can check out. And speaking of, even early game, you want to check these books out as regularly as you can, because there is this achievement here, which requires us to check out 1,000, yes, 1,000 individual books, which the reward for is an increase to our maximum book level. Next up, we have the Deathnote. I may cop some flack for calling the Deathnote complex because it's really not all that complicated. The Deathnote itself counts how many times you've killed each mob type, and if we look here, we can see at certain milestones we get points. And this is where it gets complicated, at least for me. These points increase the number here, which I believe is how many kills each single kill will count for. And this number here is the multiplier on the resources that will drop. Honestly, I don't fully understand it all myself, but bigger number better and make things go brr. In essence, you'll want to eventually push each mob type out to the highest tier so you can get more multi-kill, which will help with resource collection. And it's just another thing to fuck with your obsessive compulsive tendencies. The third and final slightly complicated system is the salt lick. Which I kind of jest. The salt lick isn't all that complicated. I just wanted a slightly less info dumpy segment here before we went over 3D printing. Leveling up the Salt Lick will unlock new bonuses that you can level up in this interface here, and should be yet another thing that we want to eventually spend some time working on. For now, I wouldn't worry about this too much, but at least unlock the first bonus and use a little bit of red salt to level this baby up. It'll be important moving forward. There really isn't anything else to the Salt Lick. Level it up to unlock the bonuses, and then level up the bonuses themselves within the Salt Lick. As I just alluded to, the final thing that we want to go over for now in construction is the 3D printer. The 3D printer is massive, but before we can go any further, this is where the second major gem purchase we want to go for comes into play, and that I saved for in my free-to-play playthrough. And that is the Crystal 3D printer, which will effectively double the number of resources that we can print per hour. If you have any gems left over like I did, I'd suggest grabbing the extra card slots, as we should have a decent stock of cards to choose from now. Before we can actually go over printing, leveling up the 3D printer in construction should be a main focus, as each level will unlock the ability to sample and print on the next character. This unlocks in order of creation, so the first level for the first character, second level is the second character, so on and so forth. Alrighty, with the 3D printer interface open, we can select which of our samples that we have taken that we would like to print. That's all. Moving on. The refinery is up next. Okay, so printing and sampling early game isn't too bad, but endgame on the other hand. When you do the World 3 intro questline, you'll unlock this talent here, which is how we will take samples. Using this ability while actively farming a material or a mob resource will sample the material or the mob drop being farmed. As I mentioned, using the 3D printer interface, you can choose from which of the samples that you've taken that you'd like to print. The Crystal 3D printer unlocks this second slot here, meaning that we can double what we are printing or print two separate materials at once. There is really a lot that can affect your sample size, so whenever you go to sample any resource, make sure you're in your skilling spec, you switch to skilling cards and set. A lot of premium items do have bonuses that affect samples, but this is a free-to-play guide, so I don't have to touch them. Woohoo! But we are doing events, so if we have any of these event foods, save a handful of these specially for sampling, as they boost skilling speed. Skilling speed is a huge modifier for resources per hour, so these will increase your prints by a lot. This is also why we want to unlock those boost foods from the unlock tab, as having these equipped alone or along with the event foods will really give your early prints a massive boost. Just remember to unequip them when you've finished so you don't burn through your stock of the event foods. Other things you might need to think about swapping are your key rings from the dungeon, your star sign, equipping any skilling gear that you might have. There is so much more when it comes to sampling, but it's kind of out of the scope of this video, so I'll leave it at that for now.
That's quite big.
I will, however, mention that I focused on printing copper and oak pretty heavily early on because I wanted to get a million stack of both of these, as we have skills that will boost our mining efficiency and our bug catching efficiency depending on how much of each of those resources we have stored. Okay, now we're actually going to go over the refinery. And this system, above all others in the game, more than stamps, more than construction, even more than alchemy, will make you the saltiest. Anyone still there? So, the refinery is a pain, but as with a lot of things in Idleon, it's important. So let's go over what we're looking at in the refinery panel. Each of these slots will produce a different coloured salt. When starting out, we will only have access to the red salts. You can see here what resources are required to make that salt, and here is how many of that resource will be consumed each cycle, which is displayed up here. Over here, we can toggle this to see what rank each salt is, and this will be important to keep track of as we move forward. But toggling back here, we can see how much salt we have saved up. If we let this bar fill all of the way up, we can then rank up that particular salt, which will increase how much salt you produce per cycle, but also the cost. We can click this button here if we are super impatient and want to grab the salt produced thus far early, but I'd advise against this. This little wrench here can be toggled to set a salt to automatically refine once a certain amount has been produced. For your red salts, you want to leave this on 0% and try and only withdraw salts when you can rank them up. You'll always want to rank up red as you proceed through the game. There's a nifty little graph that I'll leave a link to in the description that displays what salt ranks you want to stick to. Keeping this running 100% of the time early game is nearly impossible, but it gets easier, especially once we unlock our elite classes in World 4. Throughout World 3, my copper print was more than enough to keep this going, but I did have to use two characters to farm out green mushroom caps just to keep the red salts flowing. So do your best, and if you can unlock up to the blue salts by the time you've finished World 3, you're doing good. Alright, the last thing we need to go over is the cheese or fight, and then I'll explain why I wanted to push through World 3 as quickly as possible. If you haven't by now, before the cheese or fight, you will want to make a new set of Amarok armor to use the World 3 stones on for the extra armor, because we will be tanking a few hits here and there. As always, before we go over the fight, let's go over the key quests. To start getting your daily keys, you'll need to complete all three of Ballo's quests. That's this dude, by the way. The first quest has us killing 50 Neptunes. The second wants us to boost our experience gain enough to get 3200 experience from a single Neptune kill. This is fairly easy with a few cards that we should already have. And the third and final quest is to kill a giant Neptune, which you will need to unlock a certain prayer and have that equipped to get it to spawn. Luckily, each of these quests reward keys, so you can actually complete the first quest and head on in if you're confident enough in the fight. Just like with every other world, you can try your luck in the Colosseum to try and get boss keys from there. Thankfully, Cheezor is probably the simplest of the fights so far. There's really only three things that we need to watch out for. Cheezor has no healing mechanic or tricky one-shot mechanic, so as long as we have the accuracy, we can fight this guy as soon as we reach the map and have a key. When I fought Cheezor, it took 46 minutes on stream to get him down.
No, seriously, look, this is this episode? And this is the entirety of my Cheezor fight.
I had very low damage but 100% accuracy because I was still focusing on Chakrasy and my wisdom bubbles pretty hard. But we ended up getting it done. So let's go over the fight so you too can snag that shiny portal crystal. As always, we want to go into this fight packing heat, food, as we will be tanking a few things here and there. There's a couple of attacks we will need to dodge, but the gimmick in this fight is when the boss lifts his head like this and the crystal spins around, orbs are going to spawn on these altar things around the arena. While these orbs are up, the boss will have a shield reducing all incoming damage to 10, so we want to run around and smash all of these, then go back to smashing the boss. Not like that, get your mind out of the gutter. While attacking the boss's front leg, Cheezor will dip his head, his horn will grow larger, again, mind out of the gutter guys. When you see this, just run forward a little bit and this attack will miss you. You want to dodge this as it hurts. Move back after the attack and continue whacking the leg. If you don't move back far enough, you might encounter the other attack we will need to dodge. If we are too far under the boss, he will lift his leg and stomp the ground. Simply run back out of the AoE range of the attack, which is around here. Once he has stomped the ground, you are free to run back in and continue attacking. The other thing that will be happening periodically is Cheezor will spawn frozen stalactites that will fall from the ceiling. These don't hurt all that much and is why we wanted food. Just tank these and focus on breaking those crystals, dodging those other two attacks, and before long, or well, after nearly an hour or so, you too should be able to sneak in to World 4. Which finally brings me to why I wanted to focus on getting to World 4 as soon as possible. World 4 will take you a lot longer to get through, as this is where the portal requirements really start to skyrocket, as well as defense and accuracy requirements following suit. All of the World 4 skills are heavily time-gated or RNG dependent, so getting these cooking earlier rather than later is just a net positive in my opinion. And with the increase in difficulty, it's the perfect time to chill on vertical progression or pushing through the game, and focus on horizontal progression or pushing the systems that we've already unlocked in the game, catching them up to where they should be, before we make our big push into World 5. Also, World 4 is where we will unlock everyone's elite classes, which are huge for gains, both active and AFK, skilling and combat-wise. I plan on getting another one of those short "This is how I tackled X World" videos out pretty quickly after this video, so keep your eyes out for that. If you found this video helpful or entertaining and you haven't yet, please smash that subscribe button. We're getting close to 1,000 subscribers, which blows my mind, and I wanted to say a massive thank you to all of those who do watch my content. Honestly guys, I'm terrible at expressing gratitude, but genuinely, I do appreciate each and every one of you who do tune into my content. Hit that like button if you like the video. You can also catch this playthrough and a lot of other Idleon content live on Twitch. My link will be in the description, but with all of that being said, I've been Titanicllama, you've been watching a video, and I'm out. Peace.